last week was the anniversary of our 6.8 earthquake, so I'm going to take it on memory lane and give you an idea what it was like. So this is an encore presentation of our show we had directly after the earthquake, the Nisqually quake of 2001. And so just to remind you, and I will show it to you in its entirety, so enjoy. Well, if you can.
It's time for the visit with the person of high strangeness. We're deliberately going to take you on some shaky ground today. Our graphics, the guests, everything we're going to do today is shaky. And the purpose for that is to kind of talk about, in case you have not heard, Washington State had a 6.8 earthquake on February the 28th. Now, this is not the actual earthquake show with all the victims and survivors, actually, that's going to join us at a later time. We're going to talk about some of the things that led up to this event and what follows this event. And yes, I do have a tag in the back of my hat, in case it's showing. And that is because this hat is on loan and I have to return it. So if that's what you see, that is thanks to Traditions that loaned me this hat with the tag in the back. I'm going to introduce you to my guest. And there's a story attached to him also. His name is Sage. How are you, Sage?
I'm doing wonderfully well.
And you and I have never met before.
Not before last night.
Last night, okay. We're going to talk about Sage for a minute here, and then we're going to talk about what a canary is and what a canary stands for. And you presently are living in Olympia?
Right now I'm living out of my van, traveling. Mm-hmm. I'm following my Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And I will go wherever it calls me.
And that's why you ended up at this show?
Yes, mm-hmm. Indeed.
Because I'm going to go ahead in time here for a minute and tell you how we met, and then later we'll make that loop and get back to the beginning of your story. As at present, I still do not have a place to live, and so my guides. It was close to midnight, huh?
Yes, it was.
Close to midnight, decided that I needed to go uptown to buy bug spray. I wasn't really sure what for. And when I got there, I had purchased bug spray, and then I read it, and I couldn't make up my mind why I needed it, and let all the people go ahead, and then there you were. Do you remember what you said? I remember what you said.
Not exactly. You remind me.
Sage said, hi, and under the circumstances, I said, I wish I were.
That's right.
That's what I said. And we started laughing because he was carrying a bottle of wine.
Yes.
And this is how this new friend came into our life. So I'm going to go back to the beginning of this story for a minute, and then somewhere along the line, we're going to share parts of your life, okay?
Very good.
The name of this show is called Canary. And do you know what a canary is?
I do. Mm-hmm. Beautiful bird. They use to bring into the mines.
They bring it in the mines.
Yeah, to warn the miners if there's danger.
That's right. And after you watch the prediction shows and that we had, and if you refresh your memory, all throughout the last 2 years, without realizing, we did prepare for this event to happen. And I have reason to believe that I was a canary. Mm-hmm. And one of the things we have shared with the friends is the frequency changes that occur. Are you familiar with frequencies?
Absolutely.
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 See, I've never talked to you, so I don't know.
Yes.
So you cut in here at any time.
Very good.
And that you feel like. About 2 weeks before the event, my granddaughter and I, we was down at Bayview, and that's
on the waterfront there.
On the waterfront. Mm-hmm. We was up in the restaurant, and the tide was coming in, and my granddaughter noticed that the water, there was a funnel, and the water was running backward. then, you know, of course we missed it. So did you have any premonitions at all?
Of this earthquake? Mm-hmm. Not at all. I was, but I knew immediately what was going on. Mm-hmm. I was in a motel room.
Mm-hmm. May I ask which one?
Over next to Denny's, the, I think it's the Days Inn.
Oh, the Days Inn, yeah, yes. that was in the flat structure, yeah. Now, all through the show, we're going to take you to some of the, to some of the footage and some of the buildings from Olympia, because they called it the Seattle quake, but it wasn't.
Yeah, it generated much closer to here than to there, actually.
Mm-hmm. they now revised it to the Nisqually earthquake, and, in Nisqually is three, that was the epicenter, and I was 3.5 miles from there. And in, they said that Olympia as a whole sank 7 centimeters, and that's about, what, 3 inches?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we all did kind of get jarred. Now, one of the other things that preceded all of this was people was itching. Had you noticed anything like that?
No, you know, I haven't. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty, been very much in my own head lately, and dealing with frequency changes in my own body.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm at a place where I have no fear.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no reason to be warned, because I know all is well.
Oh, well. It was all well, or almost all well. We have a group of doctors in Olympia that have been working with people or canaries for many years. And one of the things is that there are certain physical changes that that affect some of us frequency people prior to an event, whether it's a volcano or an earthquake, high tides. We're pretty sensitive to almost everything. And could get back to the itching was so extreme where, I mean, people were calling my house. I'm sort of a Grand Central, somewhat of a Grand Central station, so there was extreme itching. People were very irritable. Men had heart palpitations where there was actually an overfill in the hospital with what they thought was heart patients. And and you weren't lucky once? You didn't experience anything?
No, but I did run out into the parking lot and I surfed it.
Yeah,
baby. Yeah, it was great.
But why? Yeah, because instinct tells you to bail out. Oh, this is a good opening, but to tell you what happened to me. We had, of course, we had been talking about the earthquakes, you know, and we already saw. The night before, actually, it was 11:21, my daughter came over, and I said to her, do you feel that? And she says, oh, no, here you go again, you know. And at a little after 12, I felt it again. And I called her, of course, she hadn't felt anything. And at 4 o'clock in the morning, I sat straight up because I heard something moving like metal. It was just grinding. And I said, this is it, here it comes. So I packed a bag, and I had all my documents in there, 3 pair of glasses, toothpaste, you know, things that you need. Put the coat over the bag, and I slept with my shoes on. But guess what? When that shaker came, I couldn't get to my purse because it threw me clear across the room.
Wow.
And so you can always bail out and surf the parking lot. Is this your first earthquake you've ever been in?
When I lived in Santa Barbara as a child, I felt a couple of the L.A. quakes, you know, it came up that. Mm-hmm. Four.
When I was little, I'm from North Africa. I remember the one in Algeria. I don't remember how old I was, but it actually moved the Atlas mountain range to 2 feet, and that's
wow.
A huge mountain range there. Well, having said all that, eventually what happened, being a psychic that I am, something didn't feel right, and I thought it was just because I couldn't, you know, there was so much cellular memory in my bones, that's what I thought, that my house never felt right. But actually, that's not what it was at all, because I became a casualty. It was almost, what, 10 or 12 days later, because my house sank. So The Olympia paper did a wonderful article, so I'm gonna, can I go to camera three directly, or? I wanna show you this, and you can access this. They have a, it is the news, excuse me, it's news, the Olympia, news.theolympian.com. If you go to the earthquake archives, there's all the stories of the people, the survivors, and all the things that happened to us. And so it says here that I'm the only house in Lacey that got red tagged. And of course, the only thing I was able to get out was my CT. Did we get that good? Cliff? Are we done? Wonderful. Now, haven't been able, not actually, I can't go home, so I sort of got put out of my house, and that's okay too. Now I want to get to what we experience when we're homeless, so to speak. Would you like to start us off?
It's the interesting thing for me. I chose to do this. I chose to be homeless. I decided to walk away from my past to explore a higher vibrational frequency of energy. And I feel that as our natural state of evolution towards, you might call it Christ consciousness, you might want to call it Buddhic mind, whatever. I'm pretty much east meets west and all the way around. And in order for me to access it, I had to walk away from my past to be present now and take it forward. So I've chosen to be homeless right now and just move with the spirit. Because once you surrender to the spirit and you don't follow it, it doesn't, it won't remain with you. And so that's my priority right now, is to explore that spiritual energy, to get a grip on it, and then be able to speak to the world about it, and especially my children.
Children, my grandchildren got a crash course in life to test how people would react. Now, we have done shows on the homeless to remind the friends, and but this is my first my first go around with a situation like that, and some of the places that I've looked at, I feel that I am a human being, and to live in a car or under a bridge, if that's what I choose, rather than where you know, where they have an apartment that just didn't fit my needs. So I guess I am choosing to do that too, do you think?
Oh, I believe so. I think whether we're consciously aware or not, every moment that we live is a choice, whether it's manifested through the unconscious mind or the conscious mind. Every moment is a choice.
So back to my grandchildren, because I was not able to remove anything from the home, and here it is several days later, and it's still hanging there, and they still haven't figured out how to even lift it or go into it or anything. And to, over the next few weeks, we will continue to, you know, to keep you updated on that. Anyway, I went to Merwin's to buy some clothes. Actually, I didn't buy them. The Red Cross was real wonderful. They actively came looking for me, and I was so impressed with that, and they gave me a clothes voucher. So I went to Merwin's, and with the voucher to purchase the clothes, and I asked the lady if I could please keep the hangers. Well, the hangers, you know, they are not supposed to be sold, and she was nice. She let me keep the hangers. And so taking it as a guideline, I thought, well, I told my grandchildren, let's just see what people do now. So we went to Goodwill, and I requested that I could keep the hangers. And the lady said, well, I can't do that because I really, I can't do that, we sell them. And so a lady behind her just took a few and laid it on the basket. And then we went to Value Village. And so I'm relating the story about the clothes hangers to the lady. And so I said to her, would you mind if I keep the clothes hangers? And she says, oh no. They are for sale, they're 99 cents for 10 of them. And I said, well, you missed the point in the story. And this was so valuable to the children. And then I had to go to the laundry net, and I here again repeated the story. And I told the children, I said, now watch this, maybe 10 minutes later or so. And I said to the gentleman, would you be nice enough to give me 2 garbage bags? And now let me go back a little bit. He totally agreed at how insensitive people are and all this. And yeah, this was a horrible thing that they wouldn't give me any clothes hangers. And so I said, would you be nice enough to give me 2 garbage bags? And he said, oh, not a problem. That'll be 60 cents. And, you know, we laughed for the whole evening. So what do we expect from people when, like you said, your choice was to live like this prior to this. But some of the friends now, they maybe on a different level they chose it, but right this minute they don't remember it, so they're very traumatized. So what should we expect from the people around us?
I find that I really expect very little of people, because mm-hmm. most people live in survival. Mm-hmm. And although we have civilization, that's a very, very thin veneer. When we have something like an earthquake, some mm-hmm. kind of natural disaster, it brings out the best and the worst in people. And to give you an idea, which is really an interesting thing, I don't know if you understand the term Indian giver.
Mm-hmm. I do.
Of where it came from. Mm-hmm.
No, but I don't know the, wonderful. No, I don't know how that originated, so.
And this is what created war between the Indians and the whites. The whites were dying, they were freezing to death. Mm-hmm. So the Indians, not knowing the language, brought them blankets, mm-hmm. right, in the wintertime. Well, of course, in the springtime, they don't need the blankets. I'm sure the women had spent much time making these beautiful blankets. Mm-hmm. So they will go back to get these blankets back, because
they were on loan.
They were on loan. But there was no communication. Mm-hmm. And so these blankets represented survival mm-hmm. to these people, right? And they didn't want to let it go. And they came back and said, please, at least we're on loan. We need mm-hmm. these blankets back. But there's no words that can communicate. Mm-hmm. So they went to war over the blankets. And that is where the term Indian giver came from, because the Indians gave and then took them back. But they never understood it was only a loan. Mm-hmm. And survival is so powerful in people that they must always ask for something in order to ensure that they have something. Until we learn how to walk with the Spirit, mm-hmm. where just like in the Christ mind, mm-hmm. when Jesus was saying, when you walk out into the world, you'll be provided just like the sparrows and the lilies of the field. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't, the Father provides always, mm-hmm. always. But it's that survival mind that makes us want to grab now, have now. Mm-hmm. We have a fear that it won't be there tomorrow. And that's my philosophy. And until people surrender to the Holy Spirit within themselves mm-hmm. and know that all is well in that place, they will always want to have something to hold on to, mm-hmm. to feel like they can get through.
Well, I'm really glad that you are also, even though I don't know you at all, but you're on that spiritual level, and that is great. And that's why I think maybe again here at the Canary, maybe what happened to me had to happen to me. So because I have resources and I have friends and I have lots of people that will pay attention and listen to these stories because of this. So I'm honored that we're sitting here together and letting the rest of the world know that three-dimensional type people that you know, we can go for it. We can go for it, but on a three-dimensional and practical level. One of the first things that happened during a disaster, everybody calls and they want to know if you're okay. Well, of course you're okay. You didn't get injured or very little, and you run on adrenaline for like 3 days, okay? So we're fine. And then what happens is then you started noticing, you know, injuries and problems and things that happened to you. And then you're no longer fine, but you are fine, physically you're fine. And so people will say, well, what do you need? You don't have a clue what you need, you know. So I would encourage everybody out there, if you hear of a disaster, or if you really want to do something, the best thing you can do for a person is send money. And the reason for money is now, remember earlier I said, I knew it was coming, I had all my documentation in my purse and ready to go. Because if you lock it up at the bank in a safety deposit box, look what happened to our banks. You can't get to that. First thing they will ask you, who are you? Where do you live? Can you prove it? And maybe tax statements so you can show what you do on. Because if you can prove who you are, it's nothing going to happen. And luckily, I had my documents, but if you have to go to a county office or something, there are fees attached to that, $5 for this, $3 for this. And the other thing you need to do, you need to treat yourself. Like, go to a restaurant, even if your stomach is so upset you can't eat, order what you want. And if you look at it for an hour and you can't eat it, that's fine. But you have to treat your body. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. If I didn't treat my body very, very well, mm-hmm. the body truly is the temple for the spirit that walks through the three-dimensional mm-hmm. reality. And if you don't acknowledge it and honor the body, give it beautiful things, and especially in times of duress, that it'll succumb to the stresses of the situation. But when you show the body attention and you show it love and intention, mm-hmm. it can rise above it all.
And that's what it does. You sort of kind of just, your mind overrides the rest of it. Mm-hmm. And so again, if you want to help with anything, when a person is in a stress like that, just ask them, how can I get something to you? If it's just $1 or $5, and it's just the idea that that's going to go a lot further than $2 of clothes.
Yes.
In our circumstances here, because you don't know where to put them, mm-hmm. you see. And our destruction was somewhat different than in some of the Latin American country where, I mean, they needed blankets and they needed everything. And the beer companies brought in water for the friends that didn't have water. Did you get any of that water?
I did not.
Mm-hmm. At the brewery they did.
That's mm-hmm. beautiful.
And a lot of televisions are out during a time like that. And people just have to create their own grapevine. I think we've talked enough about the earthquake itself. We will continue showing you some of the things that happened to us behind us here. And again, a canary is a person that senses things and has physical changes. And to take your mind back, I talk about the obstructions in my neck all the time. And if you remember, I was telling you that anything biological or radioactive will end up in my throat. And I do this because I can breathe half of the time. And I like the French to know I'm much better. My neck is not swollen anymore because I think everything under my house has been toxic for years.
Ah.
And now that I'm not there, my neck is so much better.
That is a beautiful point.
Here again, the canary.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, let's talk about you here for a few minutes. You said that you chose your lifestyle?
Yes, mm-hmm. I walked away from everything. I had a near-death experience recently. Mm-hmm. And as my body surrendered to death, my spirit finally mm-hmm. overlaid. In my opinion, the true Armageddon that we must confront is our spirit overlaying the body mm-hmm. and having a full presence. And as the spirit gets closer to that and closer to that, the body resists. Mm-hmm. It doesn't want to give up. It's a genetic program with mm-hmm. all the generations behind it, with the soul that's incarnated into it. Mm-hmm. And the soul's destiny is to take the mind and the spirit and rule from a righteous place, the body. Mm-hmm. My body has resisted this. I've been training to do this. I'm mm-hmm. like a Jedi Knight in training.
Oh my, oh my.
And I am a very active mind mm-hmm. pursuing this straightforward. But my body had to physically die. Mm-hmm. I was in a sailboating accident. Mm-hmm. As hypothermia set in, and my body finally, you know, it was like Leonardo DiCaprio in Titanic hanging on the edge of the boat. Body's totally frozen. Mm-hmm. I had to let go. I was physically dying anyway. I was in pre-lymphatic cancer stages. Mm-hmm. And so my body's going, oh, this is going to be a much easier death anyway. Mm-hmm. However, I have children.
Mm-hmm.
And
a beautiful
little boy I just birthed myself 9 months ago. And I talked to that child when he was 4 months old, and I said, by the time you can speak, I won't be here. Mm-hmm. Why did you come? What can I tell you? And as clear as a bell in my mind, he said, you can live. You came here to teach me how to live. You came here to teach me how to take my spirit and become a grand being.
Oh.
And as I was letting go to drown, my body, I couldn't feel it anymore. Mm-hmm. My son, in that moment, came back to me. And my body surrendered, my spirit overlaid it, and I shot out of that water and got back on that boat like a salmon jumping out of the water.
Oh, incredible.
And from that moment on, I have not looked back. Mm-hmm. I said, this is so sublime. Holy Spirit, what must I do to walk with this always? And it said, burn everything. Walk away from your past and pursue it solely. Then you will truly have something to teach your children.
How incredible.
And the rest of the world, that this is the potentiality, that this is the next step.
So a question on your near body here, on your experience here. Do you remember leaving? Did you get the information while you were gone and brought it back? Or is this all happening simultaneously?
Simultaneously.
Here? Simultaneously.
Right as I let go, right as the body can no longer sustain itself. Mm-hmm. It let go to die. The spirit said, this is my opportunity. It took it. Mm-hmm. It took over the body.
So are you the same person or are you by any chance a walk-in?
I am the same person. However, the personality hasn't changed much, but the vibrational frequency has. I'm a healer now. I can heal other people. I've healed my own body. I've healed myself of this cancer.
Oh.
I'm getting younger every day.
I asked you how young you were just a while ago. Would you tell friends how old you are?
I turned 42 on March 16th, as a matter of fact.
How about that, huh? Yeah.
Yeah, it's real, you know? And I think the miracle of you and I meeting is even just to be able to talk right now to these beautiful people.
Bug spray. And I.
That was funny. I remember saying, don't take that if you want to get high.
Yes, I know. It's
that ain't the thing you want, darling.
Yeah, because, you know, the way it came up, but you just never know, you know. There's all these beautiful stories out there, and when we guide it like that, I mean, here, now here again, see, had it not been for the earthquake and the homelessness, and so it's just a never-ending story, because it's sort of like you go way back to the ancestors, like you said. You know, this falls in place in order to this to happen and so on and so on. And so when we do, I have to remember that today too, because I'm a little discouraged, you know. I know this is part of who I am and part of my work, but then that three-dimensional mind over here, it gets kind of troublesome, you know. And it's not what's next or what about this, it's just, it came sort of, it appears to have come out of left field, but looking back on it, it didn't. I know it was going to be just like that all the time. But filling out papers and talking to people, a FEMA, one of the first things happened, you've called FEMA. The Red Cross was wonderful. They actively went looking for the people. I thought that was great. Now, the regular homeless people, unfortunately, don't get that special treatment. Mm-hmm. You know, and then, and they were, like you said, the best and the worst, and it really did bring out the best and the worst in people. Yeah. I understand you write poetry?
I do indeed.
You do? Would you like to recite a poem? And we have your guitar here too, and while we're sitting in the bubbles, would you like to?
I'd be honored.
I'm going to give you a choice because you will play us out eventually.
Yes.
So that's not the time to do that. So could you do a little number for us?
Would you, how about a poem?
Fine, poem it is.
Or prose? I wrote this down in, I don't know if you're familiar with Zion's National Park down in southern Utah. Very, very beautiful, beautiful place. I spent two seasons there.
Actually, I've been there. In fact, some of the travel shows, we showed you pictures from that park. Yes, we have.
Just beautiful. The Indians would not even go into this canyon unless they were on a vision quest. It was that sacred to them. Mm-hmm. Now it's bumper-to-bumper RVs. But this poem I call The Tapestry. Mm-hmm. And it came out almost exactly as I'm going to speak it, except I changed a couple of the I's to we, because I was speaking I to me. And I realized this is we. This is us.
Us.
The tapestry goes like this. Look at me, my friend. You say we're strangers, yet still I care. You feel alone on this planet with so many people who walk unaware. Can you feel, my friend, after so many lifetimes of confusion, playing king and pauper, raped and rapist, to complete your illusion? For it is your dream. Did you know that, my friend? We walk many paths, seeking an end, yet go on and on. The wheel keeps turning. Experience brings wisdom. The knowledge you're learning will set you free. Can you see me, my friend, through my masks, the man that I am? The purity of my being I open to you so that we'll understand. Mm. Are you finding, my friend, all that you seek in the realm of your dreams? The faces and shapes are different to all, and not quite as they seem. We weave our illusion with so many threads. What draws your attention? The blacks, greens, or reds. When all color is there and the tapestry's done, you'll know who you are, for all will be one, and you'll see. I love you, my friend. I allow you to be all that you are. Open to love, your light will grow bright as the brightest star. So weave well, my friend, and seek not to curse the things that surround you. Then the threads that you seek to make it complete will have finally found you. Your dream will be shaken. You'll slowly arise and wipe the illusions away from your eyes. Your horizons expand. You see a new sun, then ascend into light, becoming as one. And you'll be.
Wow. Wow, that was wonderful. Thank you for sharing that.
Oh, I'm honored. Thank you.
I say, for the friends that's Beth Quist's fans, I'm sure they appreciated that. We have a young lady. We did two shows with her. Her name is Beth Quist, and she came and explained how she wrote her songs and why she wrote it a certain way. So thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Okay. Which way do you want to go now?
I'm an open book, and this is a brand new page. However we want to paint it.
Mm-hmm. Any advice for you for some of the friends out there that are not able to cope with the dilemmas as well as you do? And I'm working, I have to admit, I'm working on my dilemma right now. I'm not, spiritually I'm great, but three-dimensional I'm dense.
Yeah, well, it is a three-dimension is dense. Mm-hmm. It's density. The place that I reside in now, people would call the fourth dimension. Mm-hmm. It is beyond polarity. Mm-hmm. When you're in polarity, three dimension, things are divided into positive and negative charges in order for mass to coalesce with electrons and protons and all those things. It has to have two opposing charges in order to bind mass. Love is the fourth dimension. Mm-hmm. Love is what will take care of all of the polarity stuff. It's the glue. It's beautiful. If we learn how to love ourselves first, mm-hmm. do for ourselves first, honor our bodies, be our bodies, love the temple mm-hmm. that the spirit has a pure vehicle to express through, mm-hmm. then love that we give to ourselves will radiate outward. It'll change the world. Change the world. We need 100 monkeys that love themselves. I don't know if you're familiar with the 100th monkey theory.
I am.
99 monkeys, 100th monkey. Critical mass of consciousness affected the whole genetic chain.
Yeah.
We need 100 monkeys in humans.
Oh.
In that place of love, we'll change it all. The frequencies will expand. The planet will accept us. The planet's not going to put up with us much longer. We're taking it down.
I sort of agree with that now. I'm going to stop for a minute here.
Very good.
And I just remembered something that's really worth sharing. Now, when we talk about dimensions and dualities, the friends, we have done shows on actual time shifts that we have in this area and the duality of realities. Now, a few years ago, well, actually 2 years ago, when I was in Iowa, I heard chanting in a teepee. So, but of course, when I looked in the teepee, there was no one there. And so then as I exited, the chanting started again. And so, and that was sort of the beginning of me being able to hear things in other time and space. And then eventually we were told there was the winter camp of the natives in that area, and then a wind came and blew the whole teepee away, and there was no sign of anything. Now back to where I used to live, right next to St. Martin's Pavilion, and we have shown you the UFOs flying over that area where I used to reside for 15 years. Came home one night and I heard a circle of children playing, like maybe 6 or 7 little girls, and they were doing nursery rhymes. And I stood there and I listened to them for a long time. And about the fourth day after the earthquake, I was on the phone talking to a lady in Texas. And the little girls were crying and screaming. And the lady said, "Well, my God, what do you have on TV?" And I said, "It's not on TV, it's in my head. What are you hearing?" She said, "I'm in Texas, I can hear these little girls screaming." So she actually heard it, you know, because like I said, it's in my head, how can you hear it? But she did. Then another lady came by, she was looking for me and I wasn't at home, and she came to the back door and heard the girls playing, and she thought they had just now built a school bus stop, because where I live, there's all seniors. So she was looking for the little girls. So all the time, before, during, and after, there must have been another reality there.
Wow.
Yeah, so I'm glad you took me there, because that's a good story to share. Mm. Do you experience interdimensional?
I have.
You have?
I've had an out-of-body experience. Mm-hmm. You know, I know that I'm really curious about when we change our mind. Mm-hmm. Yeah, certain major changes and choice. I've often wondered if I have a parallel existence, or do we have many, many,
That's
many
a
things,
good word.
And we just jump mm-hmm. to these different ones as we make different choices. We just are realigning ourselves with all of these, yeah. and they all have different aspects that we can move through mm-hmm. in order to experience. I do believe that this is a hologram, mm-hmm. a holographic universe, and that you know our consciousness is what binds it together ultimately mm-hmm. through the mind of God. But I have certainly made a few shifts, mm-hmm. Jumps.
I believe that some of the people that cannot deal with this particular frequency that we have right now, a lot of people are leaving, as in death. They just can't deal with it anymore. And when we talk to you about the ADD children, I mean, they come in on their frequency. And so we need to allow them to be on their frequency instead of killing their brain cells and trying to slow them down. And we have talked about that. You have any feeling on that?
I think that the whole planet, mm-hmm. everything is accelerating.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it is.
We are we're in a birthing time, a beautiful, beautiful birthing time. And if we can surrender to the frequencies of nature and allow the body to have time in nature, I think that in and of itself, if people would get out into nature, move with nature, maybe one day a week, mm-hmm. you know, they would find immense benefits of health, nature's knowledge, being a canary. Mm-hmm. Down in Zion's, it was amazing. A huge flash flood was coming. Nobody knew. All the tarantulas move up over the road, thousands of tarantulas come up mm-hmm. over the road and start going up the canyon wall. All the humans are just driving over them going, "Isn't this strange?"
Mm-hmm. That's right, yeah.
10 hours later, their homes are washed out.
Yeah.
They stayed.
They stayed, yeah, see, that's the whole thing. You know, how we started off the show, there were so many indications. And now that we know this, you know, but scientists don't want to hear about these things. I tried to talk to some of the people in the media. And it's not that we tell you this after the fact. I bet you if I went back in some of the shows where, without realizing it, we have documented all these things, and there are canaries there. All you have to do is pay attention, and maybe people like myself, eventually we can save your life, you know. And like in the 80s, there was a government program where they monitored people like, you know, canaries like myself. And then during the Reagan administration, they cut that off. And so it would be a wonderful thing if enough people was to request to bring something like that back. Any advice for the friends that just absolutely can't cope? I think I asked you that a while ago, and then we went into the spiritual aspect. Can you now give some physical hints for some of the friends that just don't know how to cope right now?
Not to be afraid to ask. Mm-hmm. I think the most difficult thing as a human being, we are trained to not feel worthy. Mm-hmm. We are educated into being unworthy. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes down to it, where we have the stress, we feel all this overwhelming reality around us, mm-hmm. all the three-dimensional things that we've manifested, you know. And we're overwhelmed with it.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to let it go, number one. If it's, if it's too heavy, let it go.
Let it go.
Let it go. Walk away. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, don't be afraid to ask for help. Mm-hmm. Know that your neighbor, if you are truly living the golden rule, mm-hmm. treating other people like you want to be treated, you have a right to walk up to your neighbor and ask them for assistance and deserve receiving it. Mm-hmm. If they, and hopefully they'll be able to see and give freely. Mm-hmm. But I think we have problems asking for help.
Yeah, we do. And then if you don't get it, don't take it personal, because we all go into this trauma here. You know, and like the lady there, excuse me, with the clothes hangers, it was, I said to her, you know, you missed the point in the story, and I smiled at her because I really didn't need her clothes hangers. That was just a test to see how we was going to do that. And people in the Northwest, you know, we're always doing things for other people. And I think we've been, have you driven to town at all?
Yes.
I don't think there is any, there is nobody that's not affected. I mean, the roads got, some of the roads got rebuilt, but I don't think there is a house in this town that is like it was before. And if you remember the prediction show in October, I said, life as you know it is over. And, you know, that really became a true statement here. What are your plans?
Right now, I'm having to manifest money. Mm-hmm. And this is a great, great lesson, to walk out the door and leave all behind and know that the Father will provide today, the Father principle, the divine principle, whatever you want to call it, mother, father principle. Yeah. It's not a sex to me. It's just is.
I call it the universe, because the universe has more letters than God, so I kind of that.
It sounds pretty too.
Yeah.
I'm at a place where I'm going to have to surrender to working again. Or I'm going to have to move into a place of asking plainly, straightforward, and receiving and feeling the worthiness. That is, that's the true test, is to is to ask, knowing you're worthy, and also not to be afraid of being rejected. To ask and know that when they say no, I can't do that, to still love yourself, still smile, and honor the person. Thank you. For hearing my request, I understand that you do not feel like you're giving.
Yeah.
That's all right. Mm-hmm. And go on. But every day, I just wake up and I bless my day. Mm-hmm. And I walk into the world. And just as I ask the Father to provide, you were my reflection last night.
Wow. Because
I had the last of my money. What did I want? I wanted a nice bottle of wine. I wanted the bottle of wine that I wanted. I was willing to spend every dime I had on it. Mm-hmm. And here, you bought it for me.
I did, didn't I?
You were my answer.
Yeah.
You gifted me. So when I walk into my day, if anybody asks me for my time, mm-hmm. if anybody asks, I have to surrender and honor that I am the reflection that their God has sent them. Mm-hmm. And so it makes it very difficult to have plans. It makes it very difficult to know where one's going when you're a servant to humanity from a level of love. And I would rather have nothing and serve humanity than own it all. all the riches.
Every time you see Canary, think about this wonderful conversation. That's all the one we ever bought. But that's just how it goes. Let's see, what do I want to do? I don't know what I want to do. I'm looking for a place to live. Me and Miss E.T., that you know, the kitty that comes on the show sometimes. Actually, all I want is Miss E.T., the cropper, and myself. And if I can accomplish that, it's time for me to go on the road again, you know, and experience all these wonderful people. And your children, are you in touch with your children?
I got to see them on my birthday for the first time since I walked away. My significant other doesn't really understand or believe I'm in this place.
But you cannot expect, now that's something I can speak on, you cannot expect three-dimensional people to understand what we feel or why we do things. And so when you hear in the middle of the night, oh, here's another thing that happened. At 4 o'clock in the morning, someone woke me up and I heard this voice. It said, go uptown. And I heard the music from, in the heat of the night, there's trouble everywhere. And so I got out of bed. I was sound, you know, almost still asleep, but not in my body. And I remember I had to go to the bathroom. But that voice was so demanding, like, go uptown now. I went to the bathroom uptown. And I believe that's the first time the house actually sank, and it probably would have scared me really bad had I been sleeping, you know. And so here, when we hear that voice and do these things, we cannot expect anyone to understand that.
I do. It just creates a rift that's unfortunate, but I know with time that she'll, you know, surrender to love.
To love, yeah. Now this our 6.8 was a dress rehearsal. So maybe we start making notes and pay attention and find alternative routes, because this time we had one street going to the west side, and make sure you have at least two plans in case the first one don't work out. We have a lot of weakened structures, and so make sure you share a lot of love with your children. They are still frightened. I went up to the schools and we talked about, you know, things like that. And the children still do want to talk about the 6.8 earthquake. And hey, hug your neighbor, you know, even if that's unacceptable in doing sometimes. Now, do we have enough time for another story, or should we? Because you said you sing. I would really like to. How many do I have? Oh, I got another. We got about another 10 minutes. Your choice. Pick a subject here for a minute.
I liked your saying about hugging your neighbor. I think that one of the most interesting things about chaos occurring, you know, is it does bring humans together. It's unfortunate we have to wait for that moment of chaos to surrender to embracing our neighbor. And it's usually out of fear and needing to be comforted or having physical needs. I think it's critical we start to get to know our neighbors. Go next door, knock on the door. How often have we lived in homes and not even known the people next door?
That's right.
Or their children. We've been raised in such a way that the government and the media, everything is dancing is to be alone. Yeah. You know, and it's getting very, very easy to be isolated with your movie and your pizza and your, you know, and hang out and not really participate with the rest of the world. I think we need to get friendly again.
Mm-hmm. We was trying to impress that on the friends when, remember I took you to the Capitol, that's now pretty much in shambles, and we showed you the AIDS quilts. And one of the things I was telling you then, you know, instead of going to visit the exhibit, get to know the person and talk to them, ask who are you, what are you all about, instead of waiting till you read it on the quilt, no matter how much love went into that piece of quilt. Meet the people, and this way you don't have to wait for the quilt to come to the to the capital of, you know, Washington, if Washington State, because chances are it's going to be a long time before they fix that dome, you know. Mm-hmm. And so that was a good point, you know. But people are so paranoid where you're I found it the other day. I went to, excuse me, I went to the store, and there was maybe 25 kids. They were just kids in you know, they were all gathered there. And for a minute, I got a little fearful, because when I travel, you go to little towns, it's okay. But when you get to the bigger cities, because the media and everything, they're just constantly telling you, you know, you have to be afraid of people. So mm-hmm. we have to rehearse not to do that.
Yeah, I wish they would make a television news program and call it Good News.
Yeah.
But it's nothing but good news on there. It shows all the things that are really great going on in the world, because it has become, well, it's like that that new movie out, 15 Minutes. I haven't seen it yet, but, you know, everything is set up for, I mean, all those horrible things we see on the news, very few of those happen in anybody's personal life. You take 20 items, put them on the news tonight, and try to overlay that this is what's happening everywhere, and it's not.
It's not.
It's not. There is so much love. There is so much available to people to participate with together in a friendly and loving way. There's no need to fear.
The news is pretty much monitored, you know, and it's here's the other thing, you know, if you want to be supportive, or if you want to help anybody, help a producer that works on a public access television, because we are not monitored. We can still speak what we want to, and with the new administration that might not be the case, you know, after a while, and that's sort of a prediction that I'm making here. But you know, come to the studio, help us do things, volunteer, give your time, give us a hand, because right now we are the canaries of the news media. What do you know?
Yes.
We're back full circle here. Mm-hmm. And I understand that you actually took classes here at one time.
I did. Mm-hmm. I did years ago. I ended up moving, mm-hmm. so I didn't finish up. But I was going to become very involved here, mm-hmm. and have a similar show.
We have a friend, Leah Leland. She's from Tucson. She is in town, and we're going to do some shows with her, and then ship him to Tucson, you know. And so he again, instead of being competitive as producers, or we work together, and we can really make a difference. We can really, really make a difference to the friends.
So be it.
Is you prefer summer to winter?
No, I love all seasons.
All seasons.
All seasons. Mm-hmm. I have a particular love for autumn. Mm-hmm. I love watching the leaves turn, mm-hmm. and fall and blow.
Well, autumn is the season that makes me sad, because everything is leaving. And in the middle of all this dilemma here in March, really early March, all our trees are blooming. Have you noticed?
Oh, lovely.
And here again, that gives us hope. And I think the flowers came early because we do need hope this year, you know, to overcome some of these challenges. Excuse me. And
yes, hope is necessary. We need to turn to hope instead of cope.
That's a good one. Hope instead of cope. Yeah. And again, I really need to thank some people here that have come forward to step in and help people. Jim and Joanne, Clarkston, Martha Barnhill, Loretta Sarapelia and her brother Al, and Al Kislovich, can sometimes have problems with his name, Patricia, Michael, Tom Stahl, some of the other friends, you know, Larry Dodge. These are all the people that just came forward to help. Our crew was willing to do a show just a couple of days after the quake, and we didn't, but, you know, they were willing. So there's Cliff and Bernie and the guests and the people at the TV station, they went out and shot this footage that you see behind us. And actually I had some, but it's my house. I can't get anything out of my house, you know. And so we appreciate your comments and your phone calls. And if there's anything you would like us to cover, you let us know that. Now, in the beginning, I said this is not the actual earthquake show because while I was unable to go home, I was put in at the Bailey Inns Motel. And most of the victim survivors was there, and I talked to a lot of them. So in the next few weeks, we're all going to get together and talk about our experiences while the actual quake was going on. And see, we didn't all surf to the parking lot. Which parking lot did you say it was?
It was at the Days Inn. It was really fun. Yeah. The maids all went running out. You know, mm-hmm. They're all Mexican, didn't speak very much English. And a couple of them were crying, you know. I just surfed, hey, come on, girl, let's hang down.
I went to therapy a few days later, and my therapist, we were talking about the fact that when something like that happened, your bones run on cellular memory, and you need to walk straight or march or something so your bones don't, think that you're actually leaning.
Wow.
Again, I thank you so for coming.
Oh, darling, I'm
honored.
It was
just wonderful, thank you. Oh. And you are going to play us out of here. Would you be nice enough to play that song?
I sure will.
Here you go, we only have a...
This is, I wrote this after I got done working for Greenpeace. I knocked on many, many, many doors trying to change the world, and I realized I couldn't change myself. Mm-hmm. So
here's Sage. She's going to play us out of here. Come see us next week. Thank you very much. Bye.
We hope you enjoyed our walk down memory lane, and we can see what we learned from it, if anything at all, and I'll see you next week.
It's time to talk about what's coming down. Nothing good to hear in the news today. It won't get no better, won't just go away. It's time to find a common ground. Pulled in the reins, turn this world around. We've let it get beyond control. Lost our vision and sold our souls. We need a common ground. And all your parents, it's time to see life's not a game of monopoly. You're starving your children with too much to eat. The golden calf slain and laid at their feet. You have starved their souls, chained them as slaves to white man's gold. Deny the teachings that your children need. Forsaking love and instilling greed. We need a common ground.